Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar, Consumer Identity and Access Management as a Digital Relationship Imperative. We are joined today by guest speakers Lori Robinson, Vice President and Principal Analyst for Identity and Privacy Strategies at Gartner, and Patrick Salyer, CEO at Gigya. Now, let's welcome our first guest speaker, Lori Robinson.
Thank you so much. I'm so excited to be here to talk about consumer identity and access management. It's a topic near and dear to my heart and something that I've been covering, so I appreciate this opportunity. So let's get started. At Gartner, we talk a lot about the digital business, and the digital business has definitely arrived. The world around us has become digitized, as we say, and the next generation business is a digital business. Gartner looks at things like a company or a product or a person, and as you look across those, you can see that they're all digital. So what does that mean to you, and how does that affect consumer IT? Identity and access management really enables the digital business. There's a growing need for consumer IAM driven by this evolution of the digital business and the imperative that organizations engage directly with their customers throughout the life of their relationship. As we say, CIAM is now, CIAM being consumer IAM, and I'm sorry, I'll use that term quite a bit. So CIAM is now a mainstream business capability. It's no longer just some requirement that someone in a different department is taking care of. It really is foundational for every organization. We found that in today's digital business world, you really have to have a rich, fully featured consumer IAM program. That being said, we find that consumer IAM is often marketing and revenue driven. That's a little bit different than what we see with enterprise identity and access management, which tends to be security and risk management driven. On the consumer side, we see it as a revenue generating opportunity. Given that, it's often an initiative that is sponsored by the chief marketing officer, whereas compared to enterprise identity and access management initiatives that are sponsored by your CTO or CIO or even a CISO. Also, in this world where we are talking about marketing and revenue, it becomes so important to engage with the end user, and user experience is everything in the consumer IAM world. And we believe that consumer IAM technologies actually help enable that customer relationship because they're that first touch point. Consider that whereas we used to go to the store and we'd go to the storefront and open the front door and there would be the windows around us where merchandise was displayed, today we're first greeted by a login. And if that login experience is a bad experience, the end user typically won't stick around. They'll abandon. And so what happens with that initial login and those experiences around registration and profile management and other CIAM features is critical to building that relationship. And furthermore, identity data is the new gold in the consumer world. And what we mean by that is as you engage online with your customers, you're collecting information about them. And that information that you collect is going to be used to build a relationship with them, to contextualize their experience, to offer them products, and so on. So these things all come together and emphasize the importance of consumer IAM and what it means in the digital relationship. But I want to look a little bit more specifically at digital business enablement and the benefits of consumer IAM that actually do enable the digital business. First, I want to talk about know your customer. This is something, as Gartner analysts, we hear a lot as a major requirement for organizations considering consumer IAM. They'll come in and they'll say, we want a 360-degree view of our customer. But the reality is data elements about your customer exist in disparate sources all throughout your organization, external organizations, and the user even holds some of that data themselves. With consumer IAM, one of those primary benefits and goals is bringing that data together so that you have a unified 360-degree view of that customer. Another benefit is unifying and simplifying the customer experience. One of the things that we talk about a lot is this notion of single sign-on, where a user, they log into a system once and then they don't necessarily have to log in again. They can have seamless access to multiple systems. In the consumer IAM world, this expands a little bit further, because consider that a consumer is coming in from many different devices. They may come in from a desktop PC, or they may come in from a mobile device. More and more, we see people using things like gaming consoles or ATMs, or they may even call into a digital call center. Irregardless, that first touch point where they are engaging with the organization is where that relationship begins. And you want that experience for them to be seamless and unified across all of those devices. Also, on the back end, take, for example, a financial institution or an insurance company where the consumer has multiple accounts with that organization, but yet they consider it one relationship. Rather than making the user log on multiple times to different accounts, you want that experience to be unified as well. So in essence, what you're really trying to do is build a frictionless user experience where the user, no matter what device they're coming in on, has a unified experience and it's simple. And no matter how many accounts they have with your organization, that they have one experience. And this is what we call unification. The next benefit that I'd like to talk about is an increase in conversion rates. Your goal here is really to take anonymous users who have not yet built a relationship with your organization and convert them to known users. And this is going to play off the previous example a little bit. The way to do that is to ensure that frictionless experience, to make it really easy for them to register with you so that it takes them from just some random IP address to an actual known entity. And you can do that with things like social login. Next is improved customer relationships. So certainly consumer IAM is going to help with the experience, but by collecting data about a user as they engage with you, you're actually able to personalize and contextualize the relationship with them, which helps strengthen that relationship. So for example, you might be able to, based on their preferences, offer them targeted marketing campaigns, or you might be able to contextualize their actual online experience, and maybe it's by setting a preference such as their landing page, etc. But that's all powered by a powerful user profile. In the enterprise world, we as IAM professionals are very focused on protecting business assets. So making sure that the right users have access to the right systems. And we spend millions and millions of dollars on locking down those systems. But in the consumer world, the focus shifts from the business to the individual. And in consumer IAM, we're really worried about protecting the identity of an individual and securing their information and ensuring that they have control over how data about them is being used. So now that I've talked about some of the benefits that can be derived from a consumer IAM system, let's look at the actual consumer IAM features that enable those benefits. The first topic I want to start with is registration. Registration is really what moves an anonymous user to a known user. So I talked about conversion. It happens at the point of registration, and it really does represent a critical shift in the relationship between you and the business user. At this point, it provides an opportunity for you as an organization to collect data about your user, or your customer, if you will. And it really, as I said, lays that foundation for a rich customer identity. The next feature I would like to talk about is what we call identity proofing, or user vetting, if you will. And this step is really important when you have transactions with a consumer that require an additional level of vetting or security, if you will, if you need a higher level of assurance that the user is who they actually say they are. Consumer IAM technologies enabled this with identity proofing, which takes third-party data verification to actually vet the user. So in some cases, it might be something as simple as a data verification where they provide you with an attribute and it's a known attribute and the entity is able to verify that. In other instances, they might send you an email verification, having you click on a hyperlink to come back and verify that that was your email address. They might provide you with what we call knowledge-based authentication, where they take information from a third party and ask you questions that only you would know. They could also look at things like device fingerprinting or social footprint. But all of these things add up into a more vetted identity that is able to perform higher assurance transactions. This is actually typically done at the point of registration, and it falls underneath a registration category for that purpose. At the time a user registers is really when you want to make sure that they are who they say they are. That being said, it can also happen at authentication, and we'll talk about that in a few moments. Next feature really gets into the notion of user profile management. User profile management is a critical element to any valid consumer IAM solution. What user profile management does is allows the user to manage aspects about their identity on their profile. It also is a mechanism to collect data about a user, and that data can be collected all at once at the point of registration or incrementally over time, and I'll talk about that in a moment. We call that progressive profiling. And again, this is a way to enhance the relationship with the consumer and to gather more information from them. One of the most critical elements of user profile management is what we call consent management. So I mentioned in a consumer IAM program, certainly one of the most important elements is protecting the privacy of the consumer. And consent management is a feature that helps us do that. It really puts the user in the driver's seat, if you will, of how their information is going to be collected and shared. It provides transparency and control, if you will, over their data elements. So there's different ways that you can gather consent. You can gather consent at login, at registration, or at specific defined points of interaction. You can take control over social attribute sharing. So essentially, when you log in with a social identity, the social site is sharing specific data with your service provider. But you, as the end users, can control how that information that was received from your social site is shared with third-party entities. Also, consent management gives you the opportunity to opt in and opt out of different programs or of data sharing. And it also gives you the ability to associate or disassociate with social logins. So for example, if at the point that you log in with a social identity, you felt confident about using that, but over time you maybe decide, I don't really like my Facebook identity being linked to any of my personal accounts, and you want to remove that association, the CIAM consent management tools allow you to do that. Next step, or next feature, I should say, is progressive profiling. I mentioned that the user profile is a mechanism that allows you to collect information about your consumer. But keep in mind, one of your primary goals is having a frictionless user experience. And if when a consumer comes in, they are suddenly asked for pages and pages of forms to fill out data about themselves, they'll typically abandon. They get tired quickly when they're online. So what you need to do is implement more of a progressive collection of data, and that's what we call progressive profiling. So perhaps at the point of registration, you collect just a basic set of elements, and then through social sharing or downloads or browsing history or different transaction data, you start to build a more complete profile of the user. In some cases, you may require the user to actually provide you with more information. And rather than just throw forms in front of them, you could incent them. So for example, if a user wants to download a white paper from your site and you want to collect more information from them, perhaps before they download, you can ask them to fill out a form and provide more data. Or maybe in a retail situation, you have a user who has a basic profile but hasn't really registered with any email data or anything else, you could incent them with, say, a 15% discount coupon in order to provide you with more data. And this is, again, something that's offered by a consumer IAM solution and helps you engage and build a strong, solid relationship with your end users or your consumers over time. The next feature is what we call data aggregation. So if you remember, I talked about having that 360-degree view of your customer. That is really enabled by data aggregation. In today's environment, we have consumer data all over the place. It's distributed in many different storage devices all over. It may be, for example, that you have credit card data from a third-party provider. It may be that the end user themselves has data that they're providing. It may be that the user has multiple accounts with you and all of that data is sitting in different systems. A consumer IAM solution has to have the ability to bring that data together so that when you look at a consumer, you can see all of that information regardless of where it exists. And that's what we refer to as data aggregation. So to enable this capability of a single view of the customer, the consumer IAM solutions provide connectors or ETL technologies that help gather that data. In some instances, it may require a virtual directory service, which is represented in this slide, to bring that data together. But regardless, it's collecting data from all of these different sources into that unified view so that you get that complete picture of your customers. Talking about data, if you can imagine, if you have millions of customers and that data is spread throughout many different systems, as you can imagine, you suddenly have a whole lot of data that you have to store. So one of the features that many consumer IAM providers give is data storage. And more organizations are starting to host identity repositories in the cloud just so that they can have a more scalable solution that is able to store these large amounts of data. In the consumer IAM space, the data storage must support both a structured and non-structured data model. It must be able to handle complex relationships, especially as we move more into the model of Internet of Things, and you suddenly have a relationship not only between you and your customer, but you and your customer in a product, or you and your customer in a product and a third party. So the relationship model is becoming more and more complicated. That being said, the identity store must be extensible and able to handle all of these different data elements. So it has to be able to support schema extensions, unlimited attributes on a user record. It must be able to support indexing so that you can search this data and the ability to pull additional data on the fly. Last but not least, I want to talk about some of the authentication features that should be available inside of a consumer IAM solution. One of the things that we talk about often in the consumer IAM space, probably more than anything else, is single sign-on. And that really boils down to social login. Certainly, as I mentioned, social login enables the registration process, and you can use a social login at the point of registration to build that basic profile of your consumer. But single sign-on also and social logins also enable a more frictionless and simplified logon experience so that users don't have another username and password that they have to remember, which is so critical. Again, you want them to be able to come in and get access to the information they need quickly without having to remember cumbersome username and passwords, and being able to key off that social identity is so critical there. I'd also like to point out that with SSO, it's not just about having a single login. It's also that universal logout. And that becomes important from a security perspective so that as the user leaves a session, that all of their sessions that are linked to that particular login are canceled and you don't have open sessions sitting out there. Again, a critical feature of a CIAM solution. The next feature I would like to mention is stronger authentication, and I'm going to talk about it in the context of what we call adaptive or contextual authentication. Certainly, everyone has heard of the concept of multi-factor authentication that allows a user to use things like a one-time password on their mobile device or a hardware token or a biometric to strengthen their authentication. But sometimes different multi-factor authentication types can be too intrusive to the end user, and this is particularly true in the consumer realm. However, there are times when a user's risk increases and you have to apply those multiple layers of authentication. However, in the consumer space, you want to do that based on context. So as a user's risk increases, that's when you would start requiring those more intrusive authentication modes. And we refer to that as adaptive authentication. It is something we're seeing more and more in the consumer space. In fact, it's something that's more widely adopted in the consumer space than in the enterprise space. But again, it recognizes context. So for example, if a user is logging in from a registered computer, a username and password may be sufficient. But if they come in from a new computer or a new location or some other type of behavioral pattern that is different than normal, their risk increases and therefore their authentication must increase as well. This is typically something that happens not with brand new consumers who are just registering, but people who you have an established relationship with who've already registered for their device on their profile and things like that so that you can use something they already have as a multi-factor authentication mechanism. So given these features, I'd like to talk a little bit about architectural considerations. These are in the form of recommendations for you as you are building out a consumer IAM solution. First and foremost, be device agnostic. It's so important to make sure that that user experience is as simple as possible and as unified as possible. And to do that, you really have to imagine no matter what device a user is coming from, they should have consistent registration process. They should be able to have features and functions for managing their user profile and consent that are simple to use, again, regardless of what device it is coming from. Make sure that you enforce security, privacy, and compliance. So if you are using a third-party consumer IAM solution, make sure that they're ISO 27001 certified. Make sure that you input access controls and permissions using either group membership or roles or fine-grained access controls to ensure that as a user comes in, that they get access to the right set of data. Also, make sure you're encrypting data both at rest and in transit, and also ensure that you're adhering to your data residency and retention laws for the country that you live in. Next feature, or next recommendation, I should say, is ensure performance at scale. Going back to the fact that the consumer relationship is really enabled with consumer IAM, imagine if your end users go to log on to your site and it's not available. That takes a direct hit on your revenue or your marketing dollars. And so you've got to make sure that your system is always available, that you have load balancing, failover, and data replication in place, or that your third-party provider has those things in place to ensure that the system is always available. Given that, you also want to make sure that your system can handle performance at scale. So we're not talking about thousands of users. Again, you may find that you have tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of users who may be logging in within a specific period of time or registering within a specific period of time. And you want to make sure that your consumer IAM solution can handle that and that it can handle it, that it can perform at scale so that there's sub-second logins that can handle those traffic spikes. Next recommendation, because the consumer IAM initiative is really enabling your marketing initiatives, you want to ensure that your consumer IAM solution can integrate with MDM and marketing systems. That data is so important to your business intelligence initiatives and other marketing initiatives that you want to ensure that that data is connected and is being shared. So make sure your CIAM solution can integrate with the most common MDM systems or the ones that you're using at a minimum, and that that integration is bi-directional. Also, when you're thinking about marketing, there's all sorts of different marketing tools out there that provide data collection and analytics and things like that. You want to look at your consumer IAM solution and the marketing features that your provider actually supports, and then look at your marketing tools and look for areas of both overlap and integration, and make sure that you understand how data is flowing between those systems and which system is performing which function. That being said, this is an area that differs widely amongst the different consumer IAM vendors. You'll find that some consumer IAM vendors don't support marketing type efforts at all, while others are centered around it. Moving on to my last set of recommendations for organizations considering consumer IAM and how it can enable their digital business. Make sure as an IAM team that you engage your digital business peers immediately. Certainly, a consumer IAM solution cannot be managed in isolation. One thing that we have found is we've talked to customers that those organizations who really include consumer IAM as part of their digital initiative are the most successful, and they'll get the most out of the system. So think of CIAM as that business enablement tool that will really help with your marketing and sales initiatives. Match the scale of your implementation to vendor capabilities across different dimensions. So whether it's authentication volume, number of databases, et cetera. As you're looking for a consumer IAM solution, you want to make sure that your provider can handle those things that are relevant in your environment. So for example, you may have consumers, but the numbers are limited. And you may say to yourself, I can do something in-house fairly simple. And that may be true. But for those organizations who have very high volumes of either users or transactions or data, really need to look for a solution that can scale to match that. Consider if you require a tool that is tailored by developers or business people or both. So what we mean by this is as you look at consumer IAM tools, remember that some of them are more focused on an in-house development team, while others are ready to go out of the box for you, and you can push them out to business users or to your end users, I should say, immediately. Or there's some tools that have both capabilities. Regardless, though, you want to look for a tool that can be customized and developed and tailored to your organization so that you can do your branding and ensure that the consumer IAM solution is representative of your organization and your brand. As I mentioned briefly, make sure that your CIAM tool can handle your marketing needs so that it integrates with the marketing tools you have in your environment. With that, that is the last of my recommendations, and I will turn it back over to the moderator.
Thanks, Lori. That was Lori Robinson, Vice President and Principal Analyst for Identity and Privacy Strategies at Gartner. Lori will be back later in the program for some follow-up questions. Up next, we will hear from Patrick Salyer, CEO at Gigya. Patrick joined Gigya in 2007 and has led the company's vision, strategy, and operations. Before joining Gigya, Patrick co-founded a suite of social applications and served as a consultant for LEK Consulting, a strategy consulting firm. Patrick holds a bachelor's degree from Harvard University. Patrick, welcome, and let me turn it over to you.
Really appreciate it. Hi, everyone. My name is Patrick Salyer. I am the CEO at Gigya. For background, for those of you that don't know, Gigya is the leading provider of customer identity management. And so the perspective I'm going to come from is really from working with 700 of the largest enterprise, primarily B2C companies out there, like large retailers like Nike or ASOS, large brands like Red Bull, large media companies like NBC and Fox. We actually manage login registration, just customer identity management in general for over 700 million users. So we just had a really incredible amount of learning and really want to build off the presentation that Lori just went through. Lori did a fantastic job of really talking about the critical features, functionality, architecture that you really have to think about when you build out a customer identity management platform. And I want to build off that. I first want to start by talking through a little bit about our learnings around what are the major trends impacting businesses today that are leading them to overhauling the way that they're doing customer identity management. And specifically, I'd like to dig into why the status quo isn't working. In other words, nearly every business that we end up working with had some sort of existing solution before they partnered with Gigya. And what we're really discovering is those existing solutions, which primarily have been kind of DIY homegrown solutions, really aren't keeping up with the modern day requirements. And essentially, those existing solutions are broken. And why that's really causing a tremendous amount of demand in kind of revamping or relooking at the way customer identity management's done. So with that, I'll really just jump into it. And just to begin, again, we've had a incredible amount of learnings with those 700 customers that we've worked with around what are the major trends impacting their businesses. And it really comes down to two, what we call mega trends. And the first is really kind of self-evident. It's really about consumers' demand for personalization and customization. And that's pretty obvious if you look at where consumers are spending their time, places like Facebook, Twitter, etc. And so when they come to your website, when they come to your application, they really do want a more customized, personalized experience. But here's what's new. They don't want that experience at any cost. What I mean by that is over the last 3 or 4 or 5 years, a lot of the personalization, customization has been done in a way that was not opt-in, maybe was not permission-based. It was maybe done by buying data on consumers, tracking them, and then providing more personalization, customization that way. And what we're finding is that although consumers still do want that personalized, customized experience, they want to be in control. They want it to be permission-based. They want it to be opt-in. They want it to be really two-way. And that's what customer identity management is really all about. It's about developing an individual, personalized relationship with a consumer, but one that's based on opt-in, one that's based on permission, one that's based on trust. And that's really what registration login enables. And so it's very, very powerful. And so this really, developing this customer intimacy and developing this trust is really about looking at your login registration system, ensuring that there's a best-in-class, streamlined customer experience, and one that is transparent, that is trustful. Doing this across channels, accessing through permission rich first-party data, and then connecting that data to third-party marketing, sales, and service applications to drive personalization, customization. So that's really megatrend number one, critically important today. Megatrend number two is really the imperative around increased security and governance. And at its heart, customer identity management really is about security and really is about managing privacy. So if you think about securely identifying that someone is who they say they are, but doing that in a way that doesn't hurt customer experience, right? That's going to be really, really critical. And then even further, making sure that you're adhering to the vast amounts of privacy regulation that's really starting to emerge based on, for example, which geography a user is from or what opt-ins or opt-outs that consumer may have given a business. And what's really different here is this is really becoming a must-have for organizations. This can't be kind of something that an organization doesn't put a lot of thought into. This has to be really built into the product, built into the functionality, built into the customer experience. So that's really kind of mandate number two. And what we find is that every business we work with is certainly dealing with one of these megatrends, but actually we're finding that in most cases they're dealing with both of these megatrends. Now, kind of moving forward, so these are kind of the major trends that are impacting the businesses that we're working with today. I'm probably sure they're impacting many of your businesses as well. The next question becomes, why does the system that I have in place, why is it not keeping up? You might be asking yourself, I already have a registration system. I already have a login system. I have a way that I'm managing customer identity data. So, you know, what's the problem? What's new here? Well, you know, we engage with really hundreds of businesses, both as customers and those that we talk to as prospects, really on a monthly basis. And what we've learned across speaking with all those businesses, really across every major industry, is that the incumbent solutions, the DIY solutions for managing registration, customer profiles, login, et cetera, really are broken. And they're not broken because of anything that the business did. Really, most of these systems were built in a different era. We found that most of these systems were built 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 years ago. And this was an era that was pre-social, pre-mobile, pre-big data. It was just a really different era. And I want to talk through kind of what are some of those trends, what have happened in the last 3 or 4 or 5 years that have caused those systems not to be able to keep up. The first trend that we've really noticed is this one's, you know, pretty obvious, is that move from web to mobile. And this is actually a chart that shows traffic on kind of the average website on web versus mobile. And what's interesting is web really hasn't gone away. It's just that mobile's taken off, you know, tremendously. And so what we found is that a lot of the incumbent solutions that may have been built 3, 4, 5, 6 years ago for customer registration, for login, for customer data management, they really weren't designed with this trend in mind, right? It was really designed in a web-only era. And as we know, kind of the login registration flow for a mobile experience does require a much, much different flow than one for a web experience. And then even beyond that, you can take this further where we've discovered that a lot of businesses have also grown over time. They may have acquired other companies and gone to many websites, many applications, built out new apps. And what we find is that that often leads to systems that aren't unified. In other words, there's no kind of single registration, single login system across the websites, across the applications. And that leads to a lot of disparate systems and really poor customer experiences. So it's really important when you're looking at your existing solution today and thinking, how is that experience within mobile? Is it best in class? Is it something that's keeping up? Kind of moving forward. So the death of the password is the bane of mankind, right? I think we can all agree on that. The average person has something like, you know, tens of different accounts, many, many different passwords. The forgotten password flow is the number one help desk question, and it just drives people crazy. And the good news is, you know, we think that 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 years from now, that's not going to be as much of a problem. It's not going to be as much of a problem for a couple reasons. One, Lori talked about quite a bit, which is really this movement around social login, this ability to leverage an existing social identity to register a login to a website. And that really is becoming a standard. On a given site, you may have 30 or 40% of users that choose to log in with one of these social identities. Much better experience for consumers and a much better experience for brands. But what we're finding is that we're actually moving past that. So the next phase that we've seen is actually payment providers are becoming login providers. And that's actually a really interesting trend where you can do things, especially within mobile, you can authenticate with, say, PayPal or Google Wallet, pass things like shipping and payment information for very easy authentication. Again, you don't have to create all that information from scratch, type in all that information from scratch. But finally, and this is going to be the most compelling stage, is moving to biometric authentication. So probably the most practical way that you might have experienced that so far today is things like Touch ID within an iPhone experience. That ability to log in or register with just, you know, leveraging your thumb and not having to create an account entirely from scratch is going to be, it's just such a powerful user experience and will be the standard moving forward. You know, the implications of this are really, really interesting. You start to think about today, you may have 5, 6, 7, 10, 15% of users register that visit your site. This might move that number to 30, 40, 50, 60% of registered users. And that's going to have some really powerful downstream implications to how you market, how you do customer service, et cetera. But the key point here is your existing solution today probably wasn't designed with this in mind. You may actually have gotten to a point where you're implementing social login. That's a big step. But perhaps you haven't gotten to that point of payment providers. And my guess is you certainly haven't gotten to that point of biometric authentication, things like Touch ID. So it really goes back to rethinking the way that you're doing your existing system today and integrating some of this functionality. You know, building off that, as I mentioned kind of previously, one of the major mega trends is this idea that security and privacy regulation is really a mandate. And I'll touch on those two concepts in the next couple slides. But one of the important things is security can't come at the expense of customer experience. Consumers won't allow it. Consumers need a streamlined, really best-in-class customer experience, because this is around login and registration. If you have a drop-off here, you could actually hurt your revenue. It's critically important, but you do need a more secure experience over time. Historically, these two things have been at odds, and I used kind of the RSA token here to the left as an example. This is, you know, a common mechanism specifically with employee identity and access management to ensure really secure authentication. That would never work in a consumer experience. Consumers would never allow it. Fortunately, there are new technologies emerging to ensure a higher degree of security around authentication, but not at the risk of poor customer experience. And some of those things are things like risk-based authentication. So this idea that you start seeing something that is unusual about the registration or login behavior of that particular user, only then might you ask for things like a second factor authentication or put up an extra gate within that user experience. And so that's really critically important as we're sort of thinking about new ways to become more secure, ensuring that you're still doing that in a way that has best-in-class customer experience. So privacy compliance. As I mentioned earlier, privacy regulation is really emerging in a much, much bigger way. And specifically, when you're talking about customer identity data and profile data directly from consumers, it's really becoming how you manage and leverage that data is dependent on which vertical or industry do you operate in, and really specifically, which part of the world is that consumer from? Are they a US-based user, EU-based user, Russia, China, Australia? And what rights do that consumer give you under the terms of service, the opt-in, opt out of that particular consumer? And these are things that really need to be considered when you think about how you manage login and registration and your customer database. As an example, Russia over this last year said, if you're a business and you are operating within Russia in any sort of way, have Russian users logging or registering onto your site, you actually need to store their user data within Russia, right? And that's something that just emerged in the last 12 months. So your existing solution to manage login, registration, customer database, you probably haven't had those kind of considerations built into the offering. And we're just really in the beginning of this. So there's going to be much, much more regulation that emerges in the coming years, and making sure you're kind of future-proofed is really, really critical. So looking at the regulations today and looking at your system and kind of refactoring it becomes really, really important. Now, finally, this is the marketing SaaS application ecosystem. This is something called the Lumascape folks put out, and really wanted to represent it because there are so many different applications out there that ultimately require customer data to operate, to do more personalized marketing, more personalized customer experience, more personalized sales. And these are things like email tools, marketing automation tools, data management platforms, content recommendations, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And typically, your homegrown kind of existing solution that you have today for customer identity management was built before all of this stuff existed, right? It was built in a simpler world. Maybe you're connecting your data to just an email platform, but certainly not the 5, 10, 15, 20 different SaaS applications that exist today. And I think we're still in the second or third inning of this. My guess is that you have all sorts of business constituents across your organization that want to try kind of the latest and greatest vendor for whatever it might be. For recommendations, as an example, or for marketing automation. And you really need to meet that demand by making sure that your platform is connecting that customer data within those various systems. And so that's really something you need to kind of rethink and refactor to make sure that you can be nimble enough as the organization kind of changes over time. So it's with that lens that we sort of argue that these kind of these mega trends that are impacting these businesses are probably impacting the businesses of everyone on the call today. If you look at your existing solution, my guess is it hasn't been able to keep up with many of these kind of changes in the market, kind of the social, mobile, big data, kind of privacy, regulatory era. And so it's with that lens that we built out the customer identity management platform. And I won't go into every detail of this because I think Lori did a fantastic job talking about the features and functionalities that really are demanded by companies when they're thinking about customer identity management solutions. And I really think she nailed it. But we'll kind of just give you a sense of the breadth of the platform, really broken down to three different components. We think about as connect, collect, and convert. Connect is really going to be about the front-end experience, where we help a business take all these anonymous consumers going to their sites and apps and turn them into known, registered, identified consumers. And we do that through the core offering we call Registration as a Service, which is enabling both kind of traditional registration, but really importantly, social login, and now things like biometric authentication. We enable businesses to maximize their data collection through practices like progressive profiling, which Lori talked about. And we also ensure that this experience is very, very secure, but not in a way that compromises customer experience. So we do things like two-factor authentication and risk-based authentication. And we do this across sites. We do this across apps. We ensure that there's single sign-on across all of these and really do it in a way that maximizes customer experience. So typically, kind of the main KPIs that a business will look for here is before leveraging Gigya solution, they may have 2, 3, 4, 5% of users register that come to their websites and applications. We'll take that to 10, 15, 20, 25%. Also, typically, before a business leverages a Gigya solution, they may be collecting 4 or 5 pieces of data on each and every consumer. We really want to take that to 20, 30, 40, 50 pieces of data through optimizing the data collection flow. And we do this all in a way that makes it much, much more secure. So that's kind of the connect piece. The collect piece is really about building rich, cloud-based customer profiles. And we consolidate customer profiles across every website or application that you might have as a business, really across business units. We can consolidate different type of identities like a traditional site identity, a Facebook, Twitter, Google identity. And we do this in a way that's entirely managing the security and governance of the data. So, you know, ensuring this data is encrypted, ensuring we're storing the data in the right geographies, such as we have a data center, as an example, in the EU, one in the US, one in Australia. And then we also manage the customer preferences. So you've collected this data under certain sets of terms of service, opt-ins or opt-outs. We ensure that we're managing all of that to make sure that this data is governed in the proper way. So we talked about connect, we talked about collect. Convert is really about putting this data into action to drive better products, better marketing, better services. The first thing we do there is we have a customer insights tool. This is really a tool to allow you as a business to understand what data you might be collecting and accessing and to draw some analysis on that data. But from there, we really want to connect that data to third-party marketing, sales, and service applications. And that's where our identity exchange platform comes in. Think of this as like an app exchange for customer data. We've built integrations with the most popular email tools, marketing automation tools, ad serving tools, content recommendation tools, customer service tools, CRM tools, ultimately to put this data into action. We want to take something that may have been kind of a 6-month, 12-month integration, we take that down to a week's time frame to make sure that data really gets leveraged in an effective fashion. So again, kind of this is the scope of the platform. We'd love to kind of engage and talk to you in more detail about this, but really built this with those megatrends in mind, built this with kind of the way that we saw existing solutions be broken for our social, mobile, big data kind of privacy regulatory environment, and with the features and functionalities that Lori really kind of walked us through earlier in the presentation. You know, ultimately, all of this is about business results. And fortunately, we've worked with so many businesses that we've been able to collect some really great case studies, some really great results. And our businesses really think about it in two different ways. One is ROI and the other is TCO. So really, what's the return on investment that you can get from the solution and how much money can you save by leveraging the solution? That's really the two ways that we think about it. In terms of the return on investment, one of the key KPIs that our businesses look at are the increased registration rates. Again, so if you're getting 5% of users to register, how do you take that to 7, 8, 10%? And we find on average, we're able to increase registration rates 33%. Which is really a dramatic increase that really can transform a business. And then I'll point you to this 5x value per registered user. When you think about these two things together, it's very, very powerful. Typically, businesses that we work with see that registered users are much, much more valuable than anonymous users. And on average, it's 5x. I've seen this as much as 10 and 15 times. These are users that return back to the site more frequently. These are users that you can give a personalized, customized experience. You can remarket to them later through things like email marketing and retargeting. It becomes very, very powerful. So in general, again, really significant return on investment. But then we're also able to show a lower total cost of ownership. It's important to note that, again, this is something that's typically been done in-house. And there's teams working on this, obviously, maintaining this, building out the infrastructure. And what we're able to see is that typically we can decrease the IT infrastructure costs on average about 25%. Really save development time, both on initial implementation, but also on an ongoing basis. And we're really proud of the fact that this isn't a 12 to 24 month implementation timeline. Typically, we can get a customer live within actually a 3 month time period. So really, really quickly. So with that, you know, I just kind of want to bring together kind of our thoughts here. And again, what we're finding across these 700 customers is a commonality in these two major trends impacting their business. This idea of customer intimacy and trust, right? Consumers want personalization, customization, but not at any cost. They want an opt-in, transparent, two-way type relationship. And that's what customer identity management is really about. And the need for increased security and governance, right? It's an imperative. And really, that really starts with customer identity management. It's critically important to get right. And we would argue if you look at your existing registration profile management solution, it might not be keeping up to kind of the new mobile big data, kind of no more password type world in this world where security and compliance is just paramount. And that's really what inspired our solution to build out the leading customer identity management platform in the market. So with that, we'll close out and be happy to answer any questions that might have come up during the presentation.
Thanks, Patrick. That was Patrick Salyer, CEO at Gigya. Now, we have some time left in the program for some questions for our speakers. And let's start with Lori Robinson from Gartner. Lori, what do you think are the most significant business trends driving the adoption of customer identity management?
Thanks. That's a great question. And it's been interesting because at Gartner, we've seen a significant increase in inquiries around the topic of CIAM. And it varies. One of the just basic things that's happening inside organizations is a modernization effort where organizations have custom developed consumer IAM solutions and they are looking to move to a more modern and preferably COTS-delivered solutions. So that is one trend. The other thing that is happening, obviously, as we talked about the digital business, we feel that as more and more things are digitized and more people are offering digital services or they're interacting with their customers in a digital medium, it requires you to rethink your consumer IAM solution and the features that you're offering to your customer. And frankly, this one is probably the more obvious one, but I think people have become more fickle and we want a specific customer experience online. And for organizations who have outdated systems, they really have to modernize and ensure that they are offering that powerful customer experience.
Patrick, would you like to follow up on that same question?
Sure. Yeah, I think there's a number of different trends. One is really the importance of best-in-class customer experiences. Consumers are just demanding just a beautiful customer experience when they interact with your brand. And I think we've always known that in the offline world, but that's really becoming true in the digital world. And specifically, it's coming true to be able to provide that experience not just on web, but also on mobile. And then we're actually thinking about things like, you know, IoT experiences. So really making sure that registration login experience is really a great experience, ensuring that that's being done across devices. So that's really kind of one major trend. And I'd say a second, and we touched on a little bit during the presentation, is really the trend around privacy regulation. Like really understanding that you're managing data in the correct way, a way that you're thinking about customers' preferences, right? Opt-ins, opt-outs. You're thinking about the regulatory environment that might exist within the geography at which your consumers might be residing. That's really becoming very, very critical as well.
Let's go back to Lori for this question. Do you anticipate that there will be significantly different business trends driving identity management in 5 years than there is today? If so, in what way?
I certainly do think that it might not even be 5 years from today. We sense a change happening now. I joke all the time that identity and access management is cool again. And I think some of that is that identity has really become that enabling tool. And I'll give a specific example with the Internet of Things. As you look at what happens in a digital business where everything is digitized, the common thread is, and the identifying thread is, the identity. It's the only thing that we can really use in a perimeterless society to authenticate users and to ensure security and, frankly, privacy. So I do think that identity is becoming more and more important in that way. But what ends up happening is that it changes slightly, and the things we focus on are a little bit different. For example, in the presentation, I mentioned relationships. We used to manage identities in a very flat, hierarchical model, and that won't really work anymore. We really have to be able to build complex digital relationships. Another way it's changing is just in the type of data we're collecting. We used to be very static in our data collection, and today it has to be much more dynamic, and we have to be able to handle unstructured data and different data types. And we also, speaking of static, have to be much more agile than we used to be. It used to be that we were very focused as an industry on enterprise IAM, and you had known users coming through known processes. And that isn't true anymore, even in the enterprise space, but certainly in the consumer world, things are much more dynamic, and you have to be able to be agile and respond to that and scale, quite frankly.
Patrick, this question is for you. What do you see as the biggest business driver for starting a customer identity project?
Sure, great question. I think this is a really important question. It's important to note that, yes, these projects are driven by some sort of business objective. I mean, that's really critical to know. And what we find is those business objectives can vary. They're things like one-to-one marketing, right? Right person, right message, right time. Know more about your customer, building out a single view of the customer, cross-device identification, all of these various things. I mean, they ultimately do roll up to this idea of customer intimacy and trust being critically important to the business. But yeah, every time we engage with a customer, it's really identifying which of those things does that business really, really care about, and then looking how their existing technology may or may not enable that and how Gigya can help them do those things.
Lori, is single sign-on mainly an operations and security benefit, or can it be leveraged to drive significant new revenue? If so, how does this manifest?
I certainly think that single sign-on is both a operation and security benefit, and it does provide revenue opportunity. So it's both. It does provide that revenue opportunity. And I think the way it manifests itself is certainly by improving the end user experience and ensuring that the user engages and that you can convert users from anonymous to known users through social registration, but then you keep those users or those customers around by simplifying their experience, by making it a seamless experience. And that really ends up equating to bottom line dollars, because again, if you have an end user who has a bad experience when you are talking about a digital service, they walk away and you typically lose that customer. And it can be as simple as forgetting a username and password and not having a simple way of resetting it. So with SSO, it kind of eliminates that type of thing.
Patrick, fraud and risk are often managed elsewhere. Are you anticipating interfaces to those risk evaluations and increased synergy for real customer identity resolution?
Yeah, absolutely. As we engage with various companies, we really engage at a few different levels. One, we talked about earlier, which is what are those business drivers that are critical to that business? Two is, how does the existing technology meet those drivers, and or what needs to be kind of changed, and how can Gigya help? But three is really looking at kind of the security, fraud, and risk department and really understanding how Gigya can help enable some of those things. So it really is a three-part review process, fraud and risk being kind of a critical component of that review process. And it does usually involve different stakeholders across those three different areas as well. So that's something that, yeah, we do recommend as part of every company as they kind of review this technology, and something that we're very familiar with as a company.
Lori, as a last question for you, what's the advantage of a full platform over a set point of solutions for managing customer identity if I can achieve the same functionality with both?
Sure. So I would say architecturally, you have many different options open to you. And I think you can probably achieve similar functionality with both. But having a unified platform with a full set of capability really helps ensure that seamless integration so that you aren't having to integrate different components together and trying to make sure that you can have one system talking to another system. And it just makes the process flow a little bit easier. So from start to finish, your data flows, your business process flows, and from a technical perspective, your integration becomes much simpler.
Patrick, for the final question, in a sentence or two, can you describe how you would convince a CIO or CISO of the need for a tool like Gigya?
Yeah, it simply comes down to security and privacy. Those are really the kind of the two main components. And the fact that the environment is changing so quickly and the requirements around that are changing so quickly that you're going to need a solution that keeps up with the rate of change within those experiences. So it really just comes down to those two different components. And what we're finding is it's really not if, it's a matter of when and how. And so we really find there's a sea change in understanding that customer identity management is a critical part of the stack. And it's more about what's the functionality that's required and how are we going to get there? That really becomes the conversation today.
That's all the time we have for today. Thank you, Lori and Patrick, for your great insights and advice today. A quick program note. Gartner is an impartial, independent analyst of the information technology industry. All content provided by other enterprises is expressly the views of those enterprises and the speakers. The information should not be construed as a Gartner endorsement of said enterprises, products, or services. And finally, I want to thank you, our audience, for your time and interest today. If you have a question that wasn't answered in today's presentation or would like more information about Gigya, please visit gigya.com and click Contact Us or send an email to webinars@gigya.com. Thank you.